God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Jesus was not an Episcopalian, nor even a Christian, but he prayed the ancient prayers of Scripture, many of which feature in our prayer book. If you didn't grow up praying by the book, or maybe even praying at all, or if you find yourself simply a bit more comfortable with free-form flowing prayer, maybe those involving words, perhaps gestures, you're in good company. Plenty of folks find that it can be sometimes awkward doing this thing of interacting with God. A friend of mine once insisted there was no wrong way to pray. He was fond of telling folks, if you want to pray for a pony, you go right ahead. We don't have a prayer for that in the book, in case you were wondering. We do have lots of prayers about lots of things. Some of them are quite beautiful, and we can thank Thomas Cranmer for some of that gorgeous language. Maybe laid out like a beautiful table to sort of help us find our way into that relationship banquet where we have opportunity to be face-to-face, interacting with the living God. I find Anne Lamott's one-word prayers to be especially helpful when it comes to moving away all the things that can get in the way. You might remember one of her books was entitled by those three words, Help. Thanks. Wow. Useful prayers. Prayers we don't have to think much about. They sometimes just arise in our heart when we're having an experience of life that just sweeps us off our feet. Kind of like yesterday, if you were here, you might have felt some of those prayers welling up inside of you. All these people, all these different voices, all these ways into praying as a practice. Yes, a practice. We don't have to do it perfectly. We're always growing in the way that we are finding our way to God. These people who are talking about prayer are here reminding us that God is really more interested in us turning up than in our precise prayer methodologies. I'm a fan of methodologies. Help us feel a little more safe, a little more comfortable, but they're not actually required. My mom, who's here this weekend, some of you met her yesterday, she's the one who first taught me to pray, and to this day remains fervent, fervent in prayer. There was no night that felt normal in our house until we had prayed together at the bedside, and yes, sometimes when I was especially recalcitrant, she would say, you can pray on your own tonight, but those were the nights I cried myself to sleep. We didn't use a book back then. Just said it, whatever it was, straight from the heart. Mom's mom, my Roman Catholic grandmother, prayed with her fingers, using those well-worn beads of her rosary. She's not alone in that practice. Many Christians, Anglican, Episcopal, Catholic alike, all value that tradition. If you're someone who knits or crochets, you know it can be very grounding to have something for your hands to do, to connect your mind and your heart and your body. Engaging our body in rhythms of prayer are as common as anyone who ever prayed. They're ancient and valuable because we relate to God through all those senses. Well, that same grandmother gave me the gift of realizing my sense of smell was part of how I came to be connected with God. She once gave me a small bottle of cologne, shaped like a little girl and her dog kneeling at the bedside in prayer. And it wasn't really an aid to my learning how to pray until the day I accidentally spilled the stuff all over my bedspread. Woo! That was a day gospel. No, we get a parable. And the parables, as they so often do, are trying to teach us something essential. Today's about praying. Turns out there is a good way to go about it, which is to say, begin and don't stop. This widow that Jesus describes as tenacious enough to rouse that unjust judge, well, she makes me wonder whether Jesus might not be suggesting that prayer really takes hold of us, gripping us so tightly that we can't shake free. God sometimes does behave like that widow, breaking down the door to get our attention. How often do you get that kind of prayer experience? Prayer, most of the time, is something I want to be comforting, helping me rest assured of God's provision and protection. It's hardly something that I want to rattle me. But sometimes, prayer asks us to sit with our discomfort as we look at our lives and in the world and we encounter the realities therein. This can be a bit harder. I don't know about y'all, but it is for me. I'd rather just roll up my sleeves and go do something with the feelings that get stirred up, trying to make something happen with my own effort. But God's purposes defy our sense of timing. Sometimes God wants us to sit with what is being stirred up in us. Sometimes God intends for us to be in that place of wrestling, where perhaps our righteous indignation can be turned to a holier fire. Prayer is where the Holy Spirit rehabilitates our longings so that we can learn how to want what God wants, when it's just simply easier to cling to our desires. Have you ever discovered you were praying for something that might not offend the will of God? The Bible has all sorts of stories of people praying with mixed motives. It's pretty common for humans to want divine sanction for the plans we already have in mind. Prayer isn't limited by our small-mindedness, nor even by our sin. One of my favorite stories in Hebrew scriptures is the one about Balaam, who got paid by the bad guys to pray for a particular outcome. And Balaam's talking donkey, wow, he was not the pony of Balaam's prayers, but he was the one through whom God spoke to Balaam. We don't get that particular story in our scriptures today, but we get a complicated monarch who is reoriented through an experience of prayer that plays out like a wrestling match. Maybe this is a story that dares us to be a little more ambitious in our praying. Because Jacob, as it turns out, had no lack in the ambition department, but he hadn't yet brought that force to bear on his prayers. He kind of got scared into praying there on the banks of the river. He was dreading family reunion with his brother, the one with whom he had fallen out decades earlier, when Jacob stripped his elder brother Esau of a birthright of blessing that belonged rightfully to him. It's understandable Jacob's a little bit worried. He sends his whole household on ahead, matriarchs, children, flocks, all family possessions. And there he is, empty-handed on the banks of the Jabbok, where he wrestles a strange man until daybreak. This is not the story of the founding of the WWWF. No, Jacob, with his back against the riverbank, isn't exactly eager to unburden himself of those protective layers. But he got forced into it. God needed Jacob to divest him a little bit, especially that trickster tendency that Jacob had been wielding like King Midas's golden touch, always turning circumstances to his own betterment. That was the trait that got him into that pickle in the first place. Yes, Jacob found a way to be wildly successful, posturing his way through life as a son of promise, leveraging every opportunity to his own advantage. Probably could have given Hamilton a run for the money. But the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, knew Jacob fully burden that no longer served. Jacob's character was ripe for transformation. And in that moment, with the stranger, Jacob grapples with God's own self, praying like he never had done before, definitely not calmly on his knees at the bedside. This is legs flexed, arms flailing prayer, God tricking the trickster, besting Jacob at his own game, when Jacob's hip gets thrown out of joint. And that moment is the one where Jacob's still trying to get that edge, asking the stranger for his name, but no one in the Hebrew tradition can say the name of God. Jacob, though, gets called by a new name, Israel, and is blessed. Yes, because he now walks with a limp. This sign of vulnerability pushes him to be more reliant on God and on others than Jacob had ever chosen to be in his life. This is the time of year in our life and community where we think about how our lives are interconnected. And I did not see any wrestling match throwdowns yesterday. Emily saw lots of love washed in this campus. There was so much joy and grace and love. But this time of year is when we do sit down and think about what it means for these rhythms that we take up together of worship, prayer, service, discernment, lead us to think about how we are connected to the wider human family and what it means to let ourselves be in the grip of grace as we pray our way until God's will for us. This is the holy ground where God waits for us, where God embraces us and transforms us so that we can be people of vulnerability and blessing who are showing forth God's glory in the world. We don't have to wait for a once-in-a-lifetime Javik moment. We just have to start simply. Begin today. If you want to make it easy, you can use this book. It's okay. Or come talk to me, or any of these folks here that are leaders and prayers and people who want to be in that process of helping us grow together in our faith. There's even spiritual directors tucked into this congregation, and if you don't know what that is, there are people who do a lot of praying and listening and helping others listen to what God is inviting us to notice in our lives as we turn toward a life that is shaped by prayer's graces. So whatever you do, it's most important that you turn up. Begin and don't stop. Because in prayer, we find sufficient grace to hold us through all of life's seasons. We find space to be anchored and grounded in the love that carries us through challenge, grief, and loss. We also know that spacious haven that shields us in our joys, like we touched yesterday. However we dare to pray, whatever our reasons, God stands here, ready to embrace us, helping us release what no longer serves, and providing everything we need, like Jacob.